Okay, so this is a supply demand video. I want to take you through a basic supply demand example. I mean, when we look at supply and demand, that is how the pricing system works. And the pricing system is the bedrock of economic, is the bedrock of our capitalist economy. Because when we determine prices, in effect, what we're really doing is coming up with a value on where we want to transfer the resources we earn for the resources we want to purchase. And we do that through the pricing system. Yes, the government gets involved from time to time, but it's the constant give and take by buyers who are the demanders and sellers who are the suppliers that is the cornerstone of the supply demand system. So, this is a basic problem that you'll see on a test or that you have to be aware of. QD is the quantity demanded. Price, you can see, is the price of an item in this case. And quantity supplied is the amounts being supplied. So basically, you could put any product in a matrix like this. We're going to just, the math, like in geometry, just serves to teach us the concept. So looking at it from the law of demand side, we know that the law of demand states that the cheaper things are, or the more economical they are, the more we want to own them. So notice that, let's call these a pair of sneakers, and these are the amount of pairs that we sell per week. At $20, we would sell 100 pairs of sneakers. At $40, the buyers only want 75. Notice they want less because the price went up. At $60, buyers would buy up to 50 pairs of sneakers. At $80, 25 pairs. And at $100, 10 pairs. So you notice that the relationship is, as prices go up, the buyers will want to buy less of the product, which makes sense. It's intuitive that that's the way it should work. On the supply side, on the other hand, you'll notice that with the lower prices, the lower supply basically states that the higher the price, the more we'll want to sell something. So at $100, the sellers would be making a big profit. They'd want to sell 100 pairs of sneakers. They'd offer 100 pairs of sneakers a week. At 80, 75, 50, at 60, 25, at 40, 10, at 20. But notice at the price of 60, we get an equilibrium. That's the price where the buyers feel the value is there for the money they've earned or they've saved or however they came up with the cash. Because all money really is paper or numbers that the government backs that tells us what our work is worth or what our assets are worth. It's a way of measuring worth, and we can exchange it for other things. And the quantity supply, that's where the sellers of these sneakers realize they can make a fair economic profit. In subsequent videos, I'll talk about what a fair economic profit means. But right now, why don't we just keep it at $60 is the price. The way $3 a box for Oreos is the price. The way $30,000 is probably the price for an average good production automobile in this country. That's how prices come about. Buyers and sellers constantly negotiating to come up with a price. So notice that at $20, we're going to have a shortage of 90. 100 minus 10. At $40, we'll have a shortage of 50. And when we hit the $60 level, we reach an equilibrium. And then finally, at $80, stuff will be sitting on the shelves because the buyers don't feel that sneakers are worth 80. And obviously, at 100, you'll have a bigger surplus. So that's how you would solve that problem. But what we're really trying to illustrate is the way the law of demand and the law of supply works. It'll still be people willing to pay a lot for the sneakers, but not as many. And notice that the demand relationship is an inverse relationship, which means when the one variable moves up, the other variable moves down. When price goes up, demand goes down. When price goes down, demand goes up, while the price supply relationship is a direct relationship. So there's how we would illustrate it on a graph. So notice that at high prices, we have a low amount of demand. And as the prices drop, the demand increases. Now, the y-axis is dollars. The x-axis is quantity, and that's always how we do it. And notice it's a downward sloping curve. So just knowing how math works and how graphs work, and graphs are so important to the economist, we know that it should be a downward sloping curve in this case. And that's something that's very important, because you really want to understand graphs. You know, there are curve graphs, more, you know, again, we will be doing more intense videos about graphs and their meanings. But just a simple demand curve graph is a downward sloping curve. It's an and that represents the inverse relationship. Notice that the supply curve is an upward sloping curve. And we graph this same way we graph the demand curve. It's an upward sloping curve, and it's a curve because, and why does it slope upwards? Because at higher prices, we would sell more, and at lower prices, the suppliers want to sell less. I should say at this point that demanders could change what they demand on a moment's notice. Because you walk into a store, if you were going to buy beef and it was too expensive, you can buy chicken. You can make those decisions immediately. If the Oreos are expensive, you buy the chocolate chips and on and on and on. While the suppliers are a little bit stuck in the short run. Because in the short run, the suppliers really have to stick with whatever product they're selling. They just can't change the cookies they make immediately. But within a certain period of time, suppliers can change what they sell. And that's what a classic supply curve and demand curve look like. You have the upward sloping supply curve, you have the downward sloping demand curve, where they intersect as equilibrium price. That's how you would represent it on a graph. Pretty simple to look at. Notice a couple of other things. When the government gets involved, and the government does get involved from time to time, they can create what we call externalities. So in this case, the government can impose a ceiling on prices, which means you can't, a ceiling, it's like an upside down house. The ceiling's on the bottom, the floor is on the top. You can't charge more than a certain price for a product. So in this case, the ceiling might be a limit on how high you could charge for certain, for milk, say, for instance, because it's a commodity that people need, or housing, subsidized housing. And notice that when the government imposes a ceiling, and the government, we're the government, so we elect the government and we approve of the fact that they subsidize housing. When they do that, we don't really reach an equilibrium. Notice what happens. We reach a lower point on the scale, and that means we are going to get an artificial surplus, a shortage, because we are limiting the price that can be charged. So the difference between the two points on this graph at the ceiling, quantity D and quantity S, the difference in that will represent the artificial shortage, because we've limited, or the government has limited, the price of a certain product. In this case, we'll call it housing. With a price floor, it's the opposite. The government says you can't charge any less than a certain price. They tax things that are legal, but that aren't necessarily encouraged by the government. So things like liquor or gasoline, or where they're trying to limit the amount of gasoline that's used. Or say, for instance, liquor and gasoline are two good ones. By putting a floor on those things, the government is saying you can't charge less. So it's upside down house again. And what they do is when they put that floor on it, again, if you trace down, you're creating excess supply, because less cigarettes, less people will purchase those things because they're not trading at the equilibrium market price, but at a much higher price. So that's how you would illustrate these things. So going back to our original example, and to kind of coincide with this, when we put a floor on something, we create a shortage. And in this case, if we say you can't charge more than $20 for housing, we created a shortage of 90. When we impose a ceiling, for instance, where you can't charge less than 100, which would be like, say, tobacco or liquor, well, then you're going to wind up with less people using it. And that would be a ceiling, which would be represented by these graphs. And that's it. So I hopefully...